Hello, my name is Paul Connett. I'm a retired professor of chemistry. I live in Binghamton, New York, and I'm the executive director of the Fluoride Action Network. This is about the sixth time I've been to Calgary on this issue over the years. I'm going to be talking about fluoride's neurotoxicity and the Fluoride Action Network. From the years 2000 to 2015 and beyond, FAN has accumulated and made public the largest database in the world on fluoride's neurotoxicity. In 2015, FAN asked the National Toxicology Program, the NTP, to review the neurotoxicity of fluoride. Their report, as Dr. Garley pointed out, was published, well, made available to the public on October the 22nd, just a week ago. And as Dr. Garley pointed out, this is a draft and it's being reviewed by the National Academies now. Now, the NTP reviewed 149 human studies, 339 animal studies, 60 in vitro mechanistic studies on fluoride's neurotoxicity, and concluded that NTP concludes that fluoride is a presumed to be a cognitive neurodevelopmental hazard to humans. This is based upon a consistent pattern of findings in human studies across several different populations, showing that higher fluoride exposure is associated with decreased IQ or other cognitive effects, impairments in children. Now, this classification presumed is the second order level of certainty. So the top level is known, the second level is presumed, the next is suspected, and finally, not enough information. So this is an important finding, vindicating 23 years of my involvement in this subject. However, the NTP suggested that the studies done above 1.5 parts per million are stronger than studies done at lower than 1.5 parts per million, or more consistent. I disagree. The studies done above 1.5 parts per million are more numerous, but the studies done below 1.5 parts per million, that's the levels that we get in drinking water below that, have stronger methodologies. And I'm going to be talking about some of those studies. Dr. Garley's already talked about two. I have three more. I'm going to talk about the five hammer blows of science that shatter the notion that fluoridation is safe for our children's brains. The first study has already been covered by Dr. Garley. That's the Bashash study from 2017. This is the first study to show that the critical period of exposure is during pregnancy. It's the fetus which gets the most troubling dose of fluoride. I won't go into the details because it's already been discussed, but the basic finding was a drop of 5 to 6 IQ points with a 1 milligram per liter increase in the fluoride levels of the mother's urine. The IQ measurements were made with the children at 4 and again at 6 to 12. Now, Bashash published a second study in 2018. Using the same cohort, they showed that as the mother's urinary fluoride levels went up, so did the symptoms, prevalence of symptoms of ADHD, particularly inattention. Then the third paper has already been discussed by Dr. Garley and others. By the way, a lot of the pro-fluoridation people have criticized the methodology. That's expected, but in my written submission to this panel, I went through about 12 or 13 of the criticisms that appeared in the media following this paper and addressed all those criticisms. Most of them are unfounded. Now, this Canadian study essentially replicated the Bashash study. That's important. It wasn't the first study. It replicated the first study for maternal exposure. And the study, again, was funded by the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences and, in this time, the Canadian government. They found for a 1 milligram per liter increase in concentration of fluoride in mother's urine was associated with a 4.5-point decrease in IQ among boys, though not girls. The authors give some rational explanations of why that might be only in boys. But in the second measure of exposure, they found that lowering of IQ occurred for both boys and girls. In a podcast that accompanied this study, the editor of JAMA said that if his wife was pregnant, he would advise her not to drink fluoridated water. And again, I reiterate what Dr. Ghali said. This paper went through extensive peer review, extensive examination, twice the amount, maybe three times the amount of attention to this paper because they knew how controversial it would be. All the statistics were checked twice. Now, the fourth hammer blow came this year. Just a few weeks ago, we published a paper by Riddell et others. This is another paper from the Till group. A shocking finding. Adolescents have a three times more likely to develop ADHD symptoms in fluoridated communities compared to non-fluoridated communities in Canada. So this is shocking. There's a possibility that a major cause of ADHD in Canada may be drinking fluoridated water. It's obviously not certain. None of these things are certain, but it's a huge red flag. And you just can't dismiss these things cavalierly. If at some point, the precautionary principle must check in. And five, this has just been accepted for publication from Till and other, another study done in Canada. In this Canadian study, bottle-fed babies in fluoridated communities have lower IQ than breastfed babies. And it's worth remembering that a bottle-fed baby gets about 200 times more fluoride than a breastfed baby if the formula is made up with fluoridated tap water. Nature protects the baby from fluoride by keeping the levels low in breast milk. We remove that protection with water fluoridation. I don't believe there's any health agency in the world that availing itself of this data within the draft NTP review, which is a very, very thorough piece of work, and subsequent studies published in 2019, could produce a science-based health risk assessment that could justify adding fluoride to the public drinking water. And before I get to my conclusions, I would like to take my hat off to Dr. Ghali. I've been involved in this for 23 years, and I've yet to hear somebody say it's time to step back and look at the evidence. From somebody in an influential position, this was gold dust for my experience. I've only met three people with the integrity of Dr. Ghali in my involvement in 23 years. One was Dr. Cahoon, the principal dental officer of Auckland, who, having promoted fluoridation, then turned around when he read the evidence and opposed it. Dr. Hardy Lineback from the University of Toronto, who did the same, even apologized to his students. And now I would add Dr. Ghali to that list. Thank you, Dr. Ghali. We need that integrity. We need that objective examination of the science. And so my conclusions, for any community to start fluoridation today, with this draft NTP review, I know it's a draft, but look at the diligence that was put into that study. And all these studies on the table is reckless. The risks to fetal and infant brain development far outweigh any benefit to teeth. Brains versus teeth. Other countries have shown
Other countries have shown these benefits can be secured
by other and safer and more cost-effective means. What we need to fight tooth decay is education, education, education. And education for better dental hygiene and better diet. They're doing that in Scotland with the Child Smile program. They educate kids when they come into nursery schools how to brush their teeth. Give them healthy diets, involve the parents with that same educational process, and they've made huge progress in low-income areas in Scotland. My wife had visited the program in Glasgow. Now, here's the important point. You saw lots of photographs today of rotten teeth in children under five. A lot of that is caused by baby bottle tooth decay. That is caused when a baby sucks on a bottle of fruit juice, sugared water, milk, for hours on end, and it rots the top teeth to the gums. You cannot reverse that with water fluoridation, but you can reverse it if you educate the parents. If you educate the parents, you can reduce baby bottle tooth decay, which would be an enormous saving in avoiding those operations under anesthesia. And lastly, fluoridation is a poor investment for Calgary. Your best investment is going to be in educating children from low-income areas, educating their parents. And you've heard a lot about poor children and equity. Now, I believe in helping poor children.
Dr. Connett, I just want to let you know that you guys have 5 minutes left in your group presentation.
Okay. Well, then I would just say this. The last children that need their IQ lowered are children from low-income families. Thank you.